Thank you. the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Until he came out, and when he came out and told the Israelites what he had been commanded, the Israelites would see the face of Moses, that the skin of his face was shining, and Moses would put the veil on his face again until he went in to speak with them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Established equity.
You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob.
Proclaim the greatness of the Lord our God and fall down before his footstool.
He is the Holy One.
Since then, we have such a hope, we act with great boldness, not like Moses, who put a veil over his face to keep the people of Israel from gazing at the end of the glory that was being set aside. But their minds were hardened. Indeed, to this very day, when they hear the reading of the Old Covenant, that same veil is still there, since only in Christ is it set aside. Indeed, to this very day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their minds. But when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now the Lord is a spirit, and where the spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And all of us, with unveiled faces, seeing the glory of the Lord as though reflected in a mirror, are being transformed in the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, the Spirit. Therefore, since it is by God's mercy that we are engaged in this ministry, we do not lose heart. We have renounced the shameful things that one hides. We refuse to practice cunning or to falsify God's word. But by the opening statement of the truth, we commend ourselves to the consciousness of everyone. In the sight of God. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
About 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter and John and James and went up on the mountain to pray. And while he was praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly they saw two men, Moses and Elijah, talking to him. They appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my son, the chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone. And they kept silent in those days and told no one any of the things they had seen. On the next day, when they had come down from the mountain, a great crowd met them. Just then a man from the crowd shouted, "Teacher, I beg you to look at my son. He is my only child." Suddenly a spirit seized him, and all at once he shrieks. It convulses him until he foams at the mouth. It mauls him and will scarcely leave him. "I begged your disciples to cast it out, but they could not." Jesus answered, "You faithless and perverse generation, how much longer must I be with you and bear with you? Bring your son here." While he was coming, the demon dashed him to the ground in convulsions. But Jesus rebuked the unclean spirit, healed the boy, and gave him back to his father, and all were astounded at the greatness of God. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Just before Lent starts, Transfiguration of Jesus up on the mountain. And I love these readings. They're great. I especially love Peter. He is so relatable because he doesn't quite get it. And I know what that feels like to read scripture and sometimes just not quite get it. I wish I was the only one who could say that. I suspect I'm not the only one here. But these readings are a precursor to Lent. They're what we read right before Lent. And Lent, which is of course starting this Wednesday, is that preparation for the great Easter feast, the celebration of our Lord Jesus Christ being raised from the dead, our hope fulfilled, seeing the promises of God come true. But this week is sort of preparation for the preparation. Have any of you ever had family over to help get ready for a birthday party or an event?
Or maybe if you are fortunate enough to have a cleaner that comes by and gets ready, or a caterer that comes to prepare a dinner at your house. And if you've ever had that happen, have you ever done the mad scramble to get your house looking nice enough for the cleaner to show up to clean it? You can't see the real dirt. We have to make it just look like church dirty, not this is what my life really is dirty. That's a little bit of what we're getting today, is this let's get ready to be prepared. Let's remember what it's all about. Jesus goes up the mountain to pray and brings with him not everybody who's been following Jesus, not even all of the disciples, but just that inner circle, Peter and James and John, the troublesome brothers. Up the mountain they go with Jesus. And then there is both the most and least dramatic miracle in the New Testament. The glory of God is revealed in Jesus. He is transfigured. His face shines with glory. It harkens back to that earlier lesson. Moses going up the mountain and shining with the glory of God. It is so overwhelming, Peter doesn't know what to do. Have you ever had so much on your to-do list that you said, I need a nap?
Yeah.
Peter sees the glory of God. The text even says he doesn't know what he's saying. He says, let's build some tents and rest here a little while. Jesus, this is so amazing, let's go camping. His brain is just shut down. And then on the other side of things, it is in some ways not dramatic at all. His clothes were made tied white, extra bleached. And you go, this is the man who has been feeding 4,000 and 5,000. The lepers are cleansed, the blind see, the lame get up and walk. And his robes are really, really clean. And one of those things does not seem quite like the others. But sometimes that's where God appears to us, is not just in big dramatic moments, but in small moments as well. One of the readings for transfiguration in the Old Testament reading is Moses going up and being transfigured. But sometimes the other lesson we hear is the other figure that appears with Jesus, Elijah. And Elijah has a mountaintop moment. He is running for his life. He has just had a dramatic encounter with some false prophets, and he is very concerned that they are out for blood. So he goes up the mountain, and then it says, there is an earthquake, and there's fire, and there's a big whirlwind and a storm, and that's not where Elijah encounters God. But after all of that, there is a voice that speaks to him in the still and the quiet. And that is where Elijah encounters God. Sometimes it's in those quiet places, and sometimes it's a big, dramatic moment. Sometimes it happens at baptism. And we have the opportunity, and here I'm going to just speak to the families of those who are baptizing today. Sometimes we get those moments. It's an opportunity to celebrate new life, but also to recognize that we are changed in this moment. Those that you speak for will be transformed as they come into the family of God. In some traditions, baptism is not done with a small pouring, but you do full immersion and they go down under. And I've been able to participate in some baptisms like that. And I know there are some clergy, I have friends, who, when they take people down under the water, they let them linger for just a moment. As a reminder that this is entering into the death and new life, that there is transformation, real change happening. Now, those that I have done with full immersion baptism have tended to be older youth, mostly boys who are very excited to get to play in the water at church and wear swim trunks to church. It can be a quiet moment under the water. It has never been a still moment in my experience. But when you do this, life is changed and transformed. The family of God grows. And we are all changed because of that experience as well. As our family of God grows today, that is always a joy and a celebration. And it should remind all of us of moments in our lives where we have had transformative encounters with God. Sometimes it's moments in church, sometimes it's out on a mountaintop or in some other place. They don't come to us with warning. It's not something that you can prepare for and say, I've got it marked in my calendar, 9:35, Thursday morning, God will appear to me. All right? Where are you? It doesn't work like that. God comes to us in unexpected moments and ways. And the challenge is to be transformed and carry that light with us back out into the world. Paul says we are changed by degrees from glory to glory, reflecting more perfectly the light of Jesus Christ. And that's why after the moment of transfiguration, we get the rest of the verses that were in brackets today. The disciples go down the mountain. And immediately after this profound experience with their Lord and God, they are confronted by an angry father with their failure. I went to your disciples, and they tried, and they couldn't help me. How many of you have ever tried to help someone and not been able to do so? Really, it's just me. I'd love to be the only one, but I doubt that I am. We have those moments where it feels like we just get the rug pulled out from under us. And to go from that high to this deep low back into the world, and then just piling more on top of it, Jesus rebukes them. How long do I have to put up with your nonsense? You faithless generation. How long do I have to put up with this? Can't you do this right? Well, that's a downer. That's hard to hear. The world will be happy to knock you down a peg. The world will rejoice in seeing your failures and follies. Try to raise your children to grow up as good Christians. But they serve Jesus. They aren't Jesus. They're going to make mistakes. You will probably make mistakes as well. You'll lose your temper with each other. Occasionally say hurtful and unkind words to each other. I'd like for you to be the family that never does that, but you'd be the first. God knows that we aren't perfect. The world knows it too, and wants that to define us as all we are, our failings and shortcomings and mistakes. But we are made to be mirrors reflecting the light of God to the world. That is what we are created to be. We are washed clean in our baptism so that that mirror can shine forth with the brightness of God. We are made as we grow and have those renewing moments of change and transfiguration to reflect the light of God more and more clearly, more and more brightly as the years go on. But sometimes we get a little smudged. Sometimes we get a little dirt on us, a little sin. And it is during the season of Lent that we will take the opportunity to renew ourselves, to make ourselves clean and holy once again, to reflect the light and joy and life and love of God. So as you prepare for Lent this year, remember that it is not just about the dirt. It is not just who can flagellate themselves more, who can take on more penance or a bigger Lenten devotion or discipline. It is about reflecting the light and love of God to the world. We are made to be mirrors. We are made to let that light shine forth from us into the world, to show the world that God's love is more powerful than our failings, more powerful than sin, more powerful than death. That even in the midst of all that mess in the world, there is new life, there is joy, and there is the presence of a God who transforms us all. Amen.
We have a large crowd of baptismal parents and godparents, so we're going to squeeze in here and do a little shuffle. Candidates for holy baptism will now be presented. Seeing that these children you present are brought up in the Christian faith and life. Will you, by your prayers and witness, help these children to grow to the stature of Christ?
I will.
Do you renounce Satan and all the spiritual forces of wickedness that rebel against God? Do you renounce the evil powers of this world which corrupt and destroy the creatures of God? Do you renounce all sinful desires that draw you from the love of God? Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Savior? Do you put your whole trust in his grace and love? Do you promise to follow and obey him as your Lord? And a question to everyone here, will you who witness these vows do all in your power to support them in their life in Christ? Let us now join with these children who are committing themselves to Christ and renew our own baptismal covenant. Please stand. Do you believe in God the Father? Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, 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 the Holy Sp
continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of the bread and in the prayers. Will you persevere in resisting evil, and whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord? Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ? Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself? Will you strive for justice and peace among all people, and respect the dignity of every human being? Let us now pray for these persons who are to receive the sacrament of new birth.
Deliver them, O Lord, from the way of sin and death.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Open their hearts to your grace and truth.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Fill them with your holy and life-giving spirit.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Keep them in the faith and communion of your holy church.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Teach them to love others in the power of the Spirit.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Send them into the world in witness to your love.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Bring them to the fullness of your peace and glory.
Lord, hear our prayer. Grant, O Lord, that all who are baptized into the death of Jesus Christ, your Son, may live in the power of his resurrection, and look for him to come again in glory, who lives and reigns now and forever. Amen. The congregation may be seated. Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We thank you, Almighty God, for the gift of water. Over it the Holy Spirit moved in the beginning of creation. Through it you led the children of Israel out of their bondage in Egypt and into the land of promise. In it your Son Jesus received the baptism of John and was anointed by the Holy Spirit as the Messiah, the Christ, to lead us through his death and resurrection from the bondage of sin into everlasting life. We thank you, Father, for the water of baptism. In it we are buried with Christ in his death. By it we share in his resurrection. Through it we are reborn by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, in joyful obedience to your Son, we bring into his fellowship those who come to him in faith, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Now sanctify this water, we pray you, by the power of your Holy Spirit, that those who here are cleansed from sin and born again may continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Savior. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Blair Jacqueline, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Claire, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism, and marked as Christ's own forever. Coleman McCullough. Coleman, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Coleman, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism and marked as Christ's own forever. Amen. Silas, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Silas, you're sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism and marked as Christ's own forever. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that by water and the Holy Spirit you have bestowed upon these, your servants, the forgiveness of sin and have raised them to the new life of grace. Sustain them, O Lord, in your Holy Spirit, Give them an inquiring and discerning heart, the courage to will and to persevere, a spirit to know and to love you, and the gift of joy and wonder in all your works. Let us welcome the newly baptized. We receive you into the household of God, confess the faith of Christ crucified, proclaim resurrection, and share with us in his eternal priesthood. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Well, peace, peace. Do you think he'll let me walk down the aisle with him? If I don't let his head fall off. Okay. Peace. I think so. He's worn out. Peace, you all. Peace. Peace. Yeah, sweet. Peace. Okay, Silas, it's time for me to carry you down the aisle now. And then it'll be Blair's turn after that. Welcome to you all. We're delighted that you're here today, especially if you're here for these wonderful baptisms. And welcome to these newest Christians and to their families who are here to support them. And we will keep our vows to support them and all that we can do in their Christian life and faith, and hope you'll do the same. If you're visiting with us for the first time, we welcome you, and we hope that you'll stay after worship for a time of fellowship on the front lawn. We hope you'll fill out a visitor's card that you'll find. It starts Tuesday night at 6 o'clock, and our men's group, the Brotherhood of St. Andrew, will be cooking and serving the pancakes, and I just want to tell you that Bill Scranham has been practicing flipping pancakes for a long time, so I hope you'll show up and see his skill and eat some delicious food. And then Wednesday is Ash Wednesday, a day of obligation for Christians, and I hope that you'll find a way to be present in church, either here or somewhere else. At Trinity, we have services at noon at the chapel and 6:30 p.m. here for imposition of ashes and holy innocence. Holy Eucharist, said the wrong thing. I hope you'll try to be here on Wednesday if you can to start your Lent in a right way, and so that your Lenten resolves are starting on a sure foundation with great intention. So please be a part of that.
Other announcements? I was told to ask, to tell, I guess, that on Shrove Tuesday as well, that St. Lydia's is doing a book and bake sale at the same time as the pancake supper. So although you can come and fill up on pancakes, please plan on bringing a little extra to share to support the ministry and work that they do. They will, I don't know where in the church they'll be, but we're not so big that you can't find your way around. I know there are some.
One who loves Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
And the sorrow is forever.
Because in Jesus Christ, our Lord, you have received us as your sons and daughters, made us citizens of your kingdom, and given us the Holy Spirit to guide us into all truth. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, to forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Thank you.
Blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and your